Happy Monday and welcome to Collider TV Talk, TV Talk for TV fans. I'm your host, Sinéad DeVries, and this is our weekly show where we bring you the latest news from the world of television, plus talk about the week that was in TV. Joining us this afternoon is Josh Macuga.
What's up, Collider TV Talk fans? Here, back here on Monday, we have a jam-packed show. We're going to talk the night of series finale, I guess we're calling it. The newest episode of Mr. Robot. We watched Gamora on Sundance. There was so much TV news over the last week, so we are trying to pack in upwards of 500 stories into today's episode. Mm-hmm. I'm very, very excited, and I'm also loving Sinead's haircut today.
Oh, thanks. Or
hair stylings.
Thanks,
with
guys.
Nubs on the top. I'm a big fan.
You like the nubs on the top, huh? Interesting.
Who else is here, Sinead?
Also here is Sasha Perl-Raver.
I am feeling that Gwen Stefani realness so thanks, hard, guys. Too, Sinead. She's got it. Why? She's a teen! She's a teen!
Aw. And also here is who I've officially decided is David McGriffin.
Oh, yay!
We'll give the McGriff. McGriff the crime dog.
You said here. Your name was too common. I think the McGriffin
is it. It
is
a little
it.
Something extra, too. This is great. This is family day here. Josh, yeah. Your family's here. Your aunt and uncle got to meet him. That was
crowd.
Great.
Yeah.
We have a live audience today.
Aunt Michael's here. I'm trying to sell David into white slavery by hooking him up with my girlfriend.
Yes, I was trying to hook me up with some ladies.
Yeah.
Got my own personal Tinder app over here. This is great.
Basically, we're putting David Griffin on the auction block for any eligible young lady out there that would like to take David Griffin on a date. You also have to take Sinead, Sasha, and I out with you, and we judge the date.
Yeah, yes. No, we just, if you want to go out with David, that's fine. You just have to come through us first.
Yeah, that's exactly
because this is
right.
A fine piece of grade A man meat.
Look at that guy right
we
there.
We got to get
amazing.
Him right.
I try, you know, I do what I can do.
Hell of a golf swing, I'll give it to him. All right, Sinead, let's get this thing started. What's up first?
All right, according to The Hollywood Reporter, Iron Man director Jon Favreau has signed on to direct and executive produce the pilot episode of the straight-to-series Seth MacFarlane live-action comedy at Fox, and will remain on board as executive producer and consultant. MacFarlane wrote the pilot script, serves as executive producer, and will also star in the series as Ed, the captain of the Orville, a spaceship 300 years in the future with a less than stellar crew. Adrianne Palicki, Scott Grimes, Peter Macon, and J Lee round out the cast. Favreau has previously directed episodes of Undeclared, Revolution, and The Office, and served as an executive producer on the first season of The Shannara Chronicles. Production on the new series starts in January, and the show is expected to debut sometime in the 2017-2018 season. Sasha, does Jon Favreau joining this production add to the anticipation?
I love this so much. When I think about Jon Favreau, of course, I go back to Swingers, right? And when we think about Swingers, one of the things I think people forget is that was Doug Liman's big breakout. Mm-hmm. Like, this dude knows how to spot talent, how to cultivate it. Marvel would not be, the MCU would not be what it is if it weren't for Jon Favreau and what he's contributed. And I think he understands how to surround himself with good people, and he knows how to foster creativity around him. I love that him and Seth MacFarlane are teaming up. I think this will be incredible. And one of like the great undiscovered Favreau offerings is Zathura. People just sort of like threw that. He always jokes that people couldn't pronounce the name, so nobody saw it. But I feel like this has some elements of that. My big question though is, can he do a song and dance number? Because I just want song and dance in space.
Well, you know we're going to get a song and dance number. There's going to be like a Star Wars cantina with Seth MacFarlane doing some sort of like big band music. I think too, and a lot of things get overlooked with Jon Favreau because of late, you know, Iron Man, The Jungle Book, a lot of these are like more dramatic movies per se, but he's a really talented comedian as well. His character in The Breakup with Vince Vaughn and Jennifer Aniston was the comedic highlight of that movie. He's like, I'll kill her. I'll kill somebody. who do you want me to kill? I'll kill him. He's like, no, I don't want to kill. I mean, that he's really good. And for this is, I think, probably the most anticipated project Fox has for sure in the upcoming thing. MacFarlane doing live action. We've been waiting for TV for this for 10 years since Family Guy season one. So, bring Favreau into more stuff.
I think Favreau was one of those guys you just don't see coming. I always kind of, I guess, underappreciated him. You know, I remember seeing him in Sopranos. He was in an episode called D-Girl.
Oh, right.
Yes. Remember that? He showed up as Jon Favreau, you know, and Michael Imperioli's character, Christopher, was just so enamored by him and so happy to meet him. And he's just gotten better and better. Like, I thought after I saw, you know, Iron Man, I'm like, okay, that's probably him peaking. That's about probably as good as he can do. The Jungle Book came out. Mm-hmm. He just keeps getting better and better. So I think this is a perfect combination with Seth MacFarlane and Favreau.
And that's something else. With Jungle Book, he now has such a knowledge of how to do CGI and make it look so real that I think that bringing that to space will be very
especially cool. on a TV budget.
Yeah.
On a lower budget. I think he'll be able to handle that well.
And let's not forget his stint on Friends, you guys.
That's true.
Oh, yeah, where he was a UFC wrestler.
That's right.
No, but he was also like that billionaire that dated Monica, right?
Yes.
Yeah, there you go. Best. Nice little Friends reference from Sinead up top.
Yeah.
Always.
All right, what's next, Sinead?
According to Deadline, the much-talked-about The Departed series has landed at Amazon. The TV series will focus on a powerful Latino gang in Chicago that embeds one of its own in the police department at the same time that the police plant one of their own as an undercover in the gang. Not much else is known about where the series will go, but Detroit 187 creator Jason Richman has written the pilot for the series and will likely lead the writer's room for the show.
Ooh.
Josh, is The Departed series something that you would watch?
This is a little... Okay, here's the thing. I think, personally, that... Why do we need this? Is this like... Okay, I understand that, The Departed was based off a Chinese series. It was a three-movie series, mm-hmm. right? That they
Infernal Affairs.
Right, and, correct. And the movie was fantastic. I don't think it's Martin Scorsese's best, but it's a great movie. I just don't understand why they have to call it The Departed. I would watch an Amazon show about a Latino gang member infiltrating the police. But now it's called The Departed. There's so much pressure on this thing. When somebody slacked me last week, they're like, they're making a Departed series. And I was like, wait, Leonardo DiCaprio and Matt Damon, did they die? Like, did they die in the movie?
Spoiler.
And, yeah, sorry, yes, throw up the spoiler. Oh! Sorry, guys. If you haven't watched The Departed, it came out in 2010.
So Just in case. Sorry, guys.
Whatever year it came out, it's been a while. So I don't.
It's like 2006.
Yeah, it's back in the day.
Just call it. Like, I don't understand why we keep having to have these, like, they're going to make a TV show about the movie.
Oh, my God.
About the movie. Every week we
and
seem to
keep
getting...
choosing great movies. Yeah. Make a TV show about She's the Man. Make a TV show about
Ladybugs.
Harold and Kumar Go to White Castle.
That's actually pretty good.
They were trying to do that as an animated show. And that would have been awesome.
Yeah.
And they were planning on announcing it on 420, and then it fell apart for whatever reason.
I don't need a Departed show.
And first of all, it's not The Departed, it's The Departed.
Oh, yeah, my bad.
And it's not in Boston, it's Chicago.
It's in Chicago. For,
and there's no DiCaprio, and there's
it's
no...
It's not Irish mob, it's the Latin mob.
This is such a poop idea. I just turned in my Aunt Brownie.
I know, I love it.
Just a horrible... This is a, like, do you guys remember Bad Idea Jeans, the SNL sketch?
Yes.
Where it's like, you put these jeans on and you get all the bad ideas. Whoever came up with this at Amazon was wearing their Bad Idea Jeans when they made this green light go. It's... so terrible. And like you said, the concept, cool. Do that concept.
Awesome. Just
call it Latin Gangs in Chicago. Yeah. Call it Mi Vida Loca.
Chicago.
I'm not a title maker. I'm just saying that's a horrible idea.
David. Ricky Martin in the lead. Like, yeah. You know, if they got Ricky Martin in the show,
John
I would
Leguizamo,
watch it.
Yeah, Ricky Martin.
It's a
Benicio.
Wait,
just throw
it
all the big actors.
It'll be a Menudo reunion show.
I would watch that.
That I would watch.
Menudo versus New Edition in a Chicago gangland.
Whoa.
Well, I feel like if you're a creator, the whole like Hulu, Amazon, Netflix, this must be like a dream because you can just start throwing ideas at creators. They're like, Amazon has so much money. They don't. Amazon would be a great bit. They don't need to make television. They don't need to make shows or movies. They have Prime. You get 2-day shipping for free.
Yeah.
Come on. But
I would be in the room when like Amazon was like, you know what, guys? We're not only we're going to ship stuff to people in 2 days,
they
we're also
so
going to make
money.
Original television.
Well, I bet you somebody came in. They're probably like, hey guys, look, we have an extra $1 billion. We have nothing to do with. Like, we can give it to charity. We can start making some movies.
Get a tax write off.
Yeah,
let's
get a tax write off.
Let's
make some
ideas.
Movies. Yeah.
You know what would be cool? A Departed show. They're like, yeah, let's do that.
You know what the one thing that I do love about this is the art that Ray did for this?
Yeah, it's
is amazing. Because all the boxes
room?
Are Amazon.
I love this scene.
And they dropped
this. This is that scene when he's talking about like if he works out or not. Yeah. He's like, what are you, those like athletic kind of guys going? Yeah.
That's fantastic. Really good, yeah. That is the best thing about this. It's so
silly. It's just silly.
But luckily, Amazon is such a screwed up model that maybe they'll make a pilot and then all the fans will
I
be like, this
like
is
Amazon
a horrible
is
idea.
Just,
and then
just throwing darts, seeing what sticks. And sometimes it does stick and it turns out to be some great television shows like Catastrophe
Transparent.
And Transparent. So maybe
right.
this
Name
will
me
be.
Another one.
Maybe we'll get lucky.
Bosch.
Bosch.
Okay.
I liked Man in the High Castle.
Man,
I enjoyed
High
Castle's
it. Actually okay. really good.
So let's see what happens. Maybe they'll get lucky. It'll be one of those darts that hits a bullseye.
Jean-Claude Van Johnson.
Yeah, see, I was.
If. Come on.
No.
Man, is
like,
that a
know,
divisive
it was
issue?
Good for half. Half was good.
Half the comments were like Jean-Claude Van Johnson is gonna be awesome. The other half were like, you guys should burn for like in the show.
Oh my
but
god!
I can't
really?
Wait. Yeah.
Anyway. You guys, you don't know what fun is.
All right, let's get into this. Let's get into the superhero rundown, where we talk about all the things going on in superhero television. We had some good stuff and obviously some a bunch of stuff that came out today. We're going to get into highs and lows. But Sinead, what's first?
We were treated this weekend to an extended clip from Netflix and Marvel's much-anticipated Luke Cage series, which debuts September 30th on the streaming service. The clip is a longer version of the first teaser released after the final episode of Daredevil Season 2. Mike Coulter, the actor who plays Luke Cage, walks into a boxing gym and ruins another outfit with those pesky bullet holes. Sasha, was the teaser good, or are we just willing to watch anything Luke Cage at this point?
Both, but I have to say, after years and years of wondering where the Hulk got all those jorts,
yes,
finally, somebody being like, oh man, I need a new outfit because my superhero powers just destroyed my outfit.
If you guys didn't know, being a superhero really doesn't pay the bills, per se.
It does not.
And those Carhartt jackets he keeps wearing don't stop bullets.
That's right.
Right?
It is just poor beautiful, magnificent chest.
I don't know, did you guys watch, you know, they finally released the Comic-Con footage of the Thor, what Thor and Hulk were doing. Yeah. I love how, mm-hmm, you know, they were talking about, you know, how like he always has a purple pants. Like, I come in, I got full clothes, I come out, I have these short pants. You know, this is how it happens all the time. So, no, this is a great scene. We've already seen parts of this. This is the extended version of that. I'm already sold. Totally. I'm going to watch 100%, this no matter what. 100%. I can't wait for this.
I really hope that, like, maybe as a running joke throughout the show, he keeps taking his clothes to, like, a nice little tailor, and he's like, I can stitch this up for you. He's like, there's 47 bullet holes in this jacket. Like, I'll get it.
Well,
tomorrow.
I hope Luke gets a guy like Daredevil has.
Yeah.
A guy who works on his suit, you know, and they get kind of like the science behind it, so he gets something so he doesn't have to keep buying this outfit over and over again.
But they do consistently put out stuff that just looks so cool. I love what Netflix and Marvel are doing. They just make cool looking stuff, man.
Yeah, that's awesome.
Cool looking stuff.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Collider caught up with Supergirl producer Andrew Kreisberg at a TCA press event and spoke about the upcoming news and storylines for season 2, namely how exactly they plan on utilizing Superman, the villains who will split the Earth in the Flash musical crossover and the furthering of the Mon-El character. You can read the full interview on Collider.com, but David, did anything in the interview stand out to you as more interesting than everything else?
This is on you, David. Get it.
I am excited about Miss Martian.
Ooh, yeah.
John Jones is going to get more of a backstory. You know, Martian Manhunter was in the first season. It's one of my favorite parts about it. And he's going to get a backstory, more backstory, with Miss Martian coming on board. So I'm very excited about that. That's exciting. Miss Martian was also in Young Justice, the animated series, which we're going to talk about later. So, yeah, it's a good thing.
And also, I heard Miss Martian is into David Griffin. Put her on The Bachelorette
pool. Oh, hey, girl.
She is? Oh, I thought you knew the actress or something. No. Oh.
Oh, wow. Look at how excited he got.
Josh.
Oh, man.
Josh,
how'd you do that? Well, here, palate cleanser, you know what's really jerky is as soon as I was reading this, I was like, Mon-El, and I Googled who the actor's going to be, and it's the Schmeckelheiner who was in that horrible show that I watched all of, Contagion.
Containment.
I watched the whole thing.
Outbreak. It's one of those movies.
It's one of those. Yeah. Contagion. Oh,
every
those
one
shows
of us
suck.
On this panel has continued to watch a show that is so horrifically bad.
Contagion was my only one. Containment. Damn it. What's yours?
I'm watching The Strain and Fear the Walking Dead.
You hate yourself.
Well, you also you go between loving and hating Fear the Walking Dead
I said
every other week.
We're going to get into it later.
Wait, what's the one show that you've kept watching that you hated? I feel like David's too good for that.
Yeah, I've been letting shows go lately. I'm just letting it go.
Sinead?
I don't think I've ever done that. I mean,
so I just totally made a bold claim that it's
you
not
and I do
confirmed.
It. You and I do it. Yeah, we're both exactly. We're the idiots.
You know what I just realized right now, which is great love topic. The air is on right now. Yeah. I have a nice cool breeze going on the back of my neck, as opposed to beads of sweat going
we
down
had
there.
That's that nice. Installed just for you.
Oh,
my friend.
We have new air. Yeah. It's great. It's like this is a nice spot.
Mm-hmm.
This is great.
You're winning, sir.
Man, all right. I got some good seat.
Sinead, coming up, Mill House.
Last story in the superhero rundown. What do we got?
All right. Apparently, Legion, the new X-Men series coming to FX, will connect the X-Men movie universe. Noah Hawley, who will take on showrunning duties for Legion, debunked that idea back in June, but Bryan Singer, who's an executive producer for Legion, told The Hollywood Reporter at the Edinburgh Television Festival that the series is designed to be part of the X-Men universe. Legion and another planned X-Men series will relate to future X-Men movies, and he added it would feature an ambitious, fun, and very unique storyline. Josh, does connecting the TV and movie universes make sense?
Every time somebody we talk about this, I'm always for making the TV and movie universe together, right? Obviously, when we talked about the Speed Force and Flash meeting the other Flash in the Speed Force somewhere in the movie or the TV show. We kind of thought it was a cool idea. Mm-hmm. I've always kind of been on board that if you have like a minor DC character in the TV, just use that same actor to like put him in a DC movie or something like that. Because I think in order to, you know, keep these universes to kind of together and like get more hype for a movie or more hype for a TV show, it would be smart to do that. With the X-Men, there's so many characters. And this is, I mean, I love the trailer for this and what we got coming up for Legion, I think, is a really, really cool idea. To not include it in the X-Men movie universe, I think, would be a miss. What do you think, Dave?
I agree. I'm glad we're getting this. I'm just excited for the show in general. That trailer was so good. Yeah. I wish it was a way in the contract, Sasha, you probably know more about this than I do, that they could find a way for Chris Hemsworth, Tony Stark, all these guys to be like, look, you're getting paid, I don't know, he's making like $80 million, let's say, for like, you know, making money off the back end with Tony Stark and all that, with Robert Downey Jr. You have to appear at least once in one of these television series. Just like I'm sure the NBA and NFL guys have to appear in certain commercials that's in their contracts for the NFL. I wish there was a way to do that and they could just show up without being like such a big deal about it. I would love to see Thor show up on Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D. or something like that. They could definitely make that happen. Those guys are making so much money off these films. Maybe. Those guys are getting paid.
I'm in the anti-camp. Really? Because I feel like the TV and the movie universes, they don't need to be the same thing because they're such different mediums. Mm-hmm. So you get a different kind of storytelling depending on which avenue you're going down. And I feel like for the movie actors, they don't want to water down their brand by being like, I'm a giant movie star and here I am showing up on television. Sure. Although with Netflix and with everything, that stigma is changing. But I don't know. I don't like feeling like everything has to be interconnected because I feel like it limits the storytellers. Mm-hmm. I think that Noah Hawley is incredible. I trust him. I think Legion looks dope. But I don't want to feel like it all has to feel like one giant connected universe. I'd rather them just tell a great story, whatever mm-hmm. that might be, that can stand alone and move in whatever direction they want it to.
Yeah, I think in certain respects, obviously, I've always been like a champion of like making the universes together because I think Agents of S.H.I.E.L.D., Sinead's new favorite show, would have benefited from a lot more of like an actual like recognition from the movies to the TV show because we don't get that. Like they'll be like, oh, Iron Man was here last week. Like, yeah, oh, where is he now?
They do it so funny. They're like, oh, we found his hammer. And it's like, when Thor
the Dark World's like, oh, Thor was here. He destroyed London.
Yeah.
Oh, he's gone now, but we're here to clean
he's
up
gone.
The
PEA. Yeah. You just missed him. Yes. Oh, I was just Thor. Here.
Like, he doesn't need to take over the show, but just like Chris Hemsworth show up for like one scene. Be like, hey, guys. In his Australian, whatever he sounds like, and then leave.
I feel like Liam Hemsworth might do that. Just dress him like
no one knows the difference.
Liam Hemsworth shows up, the ratings go down. Chris, that is a burn. Sorry, Liam. Too soon. Like a good guy, but woof, that acting thing is brutal. All right.
Jeez, over here.
I went full Sasha Perl-Raver on Liam Hemsworth, I think, my bad.
What?
What?
What'd you say?
I went full Sasha Perl-Raver. You know how you like hate on a lot of stuff.
Josh is just throwing out insults left, right, and center. You know.
That bus, just back it keep up. Going. Just keep dropping back and forth. Just back up.
Let me get myself out of the hole I've dug here. We're going to talk, guys, the series finale of HBO's The Night of, the 8-part anthology series. We saw the last episode. So if you haven't seen the last episode and you want to skip this part, you see a spoiler alert there on the side. When you see the blue mark there on our little side panel, get to highs and lows or to the pilot review of Gamora. Come back because we're going to talk Night of, and then we're going to talk Mr. Robot. So if you don't want to be spoiled by those shows, click away and then come back once you've watched them. All right. I guess maybe overall thought, because a lot of like Twitter and people were very kind of on the fence about how they felt about the finale. I'll start with you, Sasha. Were you satisfied?
Somebody tweeted at me and they said, give me a 3-word review. And my review was, this is perfect.
Yeah.
It was perfect for me. I just thought it was incredible. I felt like there was, obviously the final moment. I was watching with 8 friends and we all jumped up and went, yeah! Oh,
I'm watching it. I was like, when's the cat coming? Cat's going to come. And Amanda was like, the cat's not coming. I was
the cat is coming. Know why? Because the cat represented his hope. It was John's hope. It was his belief. And if like when he gave up belief, he gave the cat away. And when we knew that he had more belief, it came back. I will say, what I thought was hilarious was there were all those pictures of like Andrea's dead body and stab wounds, and all of us could just watch that, but they started airing that commercial for animals at the ASPCA, and everybody was like, oh God, oh God, I can't look at this because it's just too upsetting. John Turturro, stunning. His closing argument, beautiful. Mm-hmm. Riz Ahmed, give these kids Oscars or Emmys right now, or give them all of it.
Just give
them Oscars too.
Give them Oscars, give them Emmys. It was so perfect. It was so well shot. The fact that it's that nobody gets away clean thing, that even though all of these people have gone through these experiences, like everybody's life was shifted. Nobody is perfect. And there's even like with a good outcome, it's still not happiness and daisies and roses. I loved it. I loved it. I loved it. I loved it. I loved it.
Three loves, David.
It's devastating. It was really hard to watch. I think for me, and I know everybody's going to get something different out of this show. I mean, depending on what your background is, how you're raised, maybe your religious upbringing. But I think one thing we can all connect with is our relationship with our parents.
Oh, God.
And hopefully everybody has at least a decent relationship. If not, I mean, that's tough too. But it's like when something goes wrong, when you lose trust with somebody, and you saw that with him and his mom, like that broke my heart. Of all the things that happened, there's so many incredible moments in that episode. But for me, that moment with Riz Ahmed, with Nas and his mom on the bed, and him like ripping, you know, his hand away and going out to buy a dime bag, whatever he was getting to smoke, and just seeing like his life is, it's shifted.
Yeah.
Like probably for the worse. Like, I don't know if he can come back from that. Maybe he will. We're not going to get a sequel. We're not going to get, I love Nas 10 years later, but we're probably not going to get that. He had that one moment, but it was beautiful at the end when he was at the bridge, George Washington Bridge. He sees her face. And of course the music, like first time ever I saw your face and all that. And that was a happy moment for him. Hopefully he can hold on to that happy moment and find peace in his life. But it's devastating because I think everybody's going to be affected. His brother, like, there was no communication with him and his brother. You know, his brother loves him. And it's
that
just
scene as they're sitting in the restaurant.
Yeah,
and the entire
it's just so
just
much. And basically, in the end, what Totoro says, which makes perfect sense, like, look, kid, everybody has their cross to bear. Excuse the, you know, because he's Muslim. I said, everybody has their cross to bear. This is your cross. I have mine. I'm going to go about my day and do what I have to do to survive. Hopefully, you can do the same. And we don't see that at the end. We don't know if Nas is going to be able to go about his day from here on out and just do what he has to do. Turtle is.
Well, but we saw him survive in prison. And I thought that
survives.
Moment where he said, what I look at when I see this kid is somebody who figured out how to survive in Rikers. Mm-hmm. And I thought that was so, because it's explaining the tattoos and everything that we've seen him do. But with Turtle, what I thought was so devastating was him sitting on the couch, knowing that he had purpose, he had meaning. And now he's, you know, making $250 to go get prostitutes out of jail or whatever. But that's why I felt like the cat was so important. The cat was key. Because it was this moment of knowing that he still had this glimmer of a heart and he hadn't been broken down by it.
Mm-hmm. Also good talk too, sorry. I think courtroom scenes are tough.
Yeah.
You know, I mean, we can watch The Good Wife, be like, you know, she's a lawyer. She's a lawyer. But with this, the courtroom scene was so good. I love when the prosecutor was talking to Nas and, you know, bringing up, you know, the Prophet Muhammad and talking basically the whole thing of honor and doing the right thing. You can see Nas's eyes start to water.
Yeah.
You know, he's just thinking, you know, he's like, yeah, maybe I could have done more. Maybe I should have done something more. And you see him like for the first time, you know, did you kill her? Yeah. I don't know. And we don't really know.
I mean,
you know, in the end they go off and they're going to go like, you know, let's go get that son of a bitch. Let's go get, you know, whoever did it. But we don't know that person did it.
Sure.
We're just assuming he did.
Of course
he did. We hope he did.
He did it.
We hope he did.
He did it.
Yeah.
But still like
that
doubt in his face though, like, I don't know. Maybe I did kill her.
But I love that when the prosecutor was like, we got more on this kid than on that guy. And then she has the
she was hesitating because at the end I'm like, is she like trying to pose for dramatic effect or is she doubting herself?
She was doubting herself.
Yeah.
And then when she decided not to go further with the prosecution after the hung jury, we were all screaming.
You see
we
their faces? Screaming. Like how pleading they were, like when they're looking at her across.
Yeah.
They're all like, please no. And then, I mean, that was such a good scene.
Josh?
No,
I agree with both of your opinions. I thought that, and we've kind of been saying it since the first episode. Like, I think I kind of thought this was probably going to how it's end because We didn't need to know who the killer really was. We just needed to see how the American justice system works and how broken down parts of it is. And to send this kid to jail and ruin his life for the foreseeable future. I mean, now he's addicted to crack or heroin. We haven't decided on what he was smoking yet, but I'm pretty sure it's crack. That he has a neck tattoo of a thing. He never, you know, it was a powerful moment for me is as he's leaving prison, Michael Kenneth Williams is hitting the heavy bag and he never gets a chance to like say goodbye because he's not sure if it was his friend or if he was just a pawn in the game of prison life.
See, I didn't see it that way. I saw it as he wanted to say goodbye. He wanted to have that connection. He wanted to have that last moment. And Michael Kenneth Williams didn't want his unicorn to feel like prison was the place to be. He had that beautiful speech where he was like, all these people, the one thing that everybody has in common is they all say they're innocent, but you have that smell of actual innocence and that's why you are like a unicorn. So he needed his unicorn to run free.
Yeah.
You think that was him just letting him go?
It was.
Get out of here, old yellow.
That was my one issue. I said it when we first saw Michael Kenneth Williams boxing, and I saw it again last night. He is such a brilliant actor. Why did they not give him 12 hours with a boxing coach?
I mean, he was the worst boxer. I actually said that. I was like, anybody taught him how to hit a heavy bag?
That
was
awful.
Brutal.
That was ridiculous.
I think that every character in the show got as much wrap up as you would get in actual life.
Yeah, it's like you can't really spoil the end of The Wire, but it's life goes on.
Life goes on.
It's just life goes on. Life continues. People just have to exist. They have to bear their cross and exist in what their life they're given. I mean, you can't have the result. There's no they solved it.
No.
You can't do that.
No.
That's not life.
It's the same kind of thing of like the war on drugs. You're never going to win the war.
Like Sicario. Sicario shows that.
You just keep
like
fighting
Narcos.
The battle.
Narcos
too. Just keep fighting the battle.
Yeah.
And unfortunately, Nas, was in the crossfire at a weird time, and in someone's life, people come into your life, and his life was ruined by one woman that stepped into a cab, and you see what life happens like after that, because he's a good kid that was unfortunately ruined by the. Bad decisions. But
I just loved it, though.
This
I loved
eight
it.
Episodes was some of the best TV you'll ever watch.
And that hour and 45 minutes flew by.
Flew by.
Yeah.
So if you didn't watch The Night Of on HBO, go and do that and let us
now
know what you guys think.
The now that we've spoiled the entire thing
for you. Come back and watch the spoiler review. All right. Let's go on to... Oh, wait. We should probably do... out of five. I mean, this gets out of five.
It gets a 10.
That's a 10.
A 10.
It's 10.
It's a 10.
If this was a television show, it would be a Sinead DeFries.
It would
let's
be.
Let's just say that. There she
is. That,
is
that
the
good?
Lovely Sinead DeFries.
It's that good.
All right, let's move on to Mr. Robot. This episode, I think, was a little bit of a departure from the other two because it was a little slow. It didn't have the same impact that we had the last two episodes because Elliot really wasn't in it. It was more Darlene and the falling apart of the group. Mm-hmm. They had their first kind of like major misstep in the group when that woman came back to her house. This was, I think this was the point in the show where you finally got the fact that Darlene can kill. Mm-hmm. And once you've crossed that boundary, now everybody around her is like, oh, this is a loose cannon. She can actually pull that trigger.
Well, wait.
No, go ahead. No, please.
So I have to admit that before we started the show, Josh was like, Sasha, are you okay? And I was like, I'm fine. I'm rereading the recap of Mr. Robot because I forgot what happened between Wednesday and today because it just wasn't that memorable. The primary thing I remembered is that I still hate Dom and I want to rip that lollipop out of her mouth and beat her over the head with it. But
the teeth must be terrible. So much sugar.
I mean, the Darlene and Cisco thing where they're like bringing the body to that incinerator. That moment I thought was really interesting because she had that beautiful moment of like, I'm paying enough for privacy.
Yeah.
And because when it actually happened, I thought that you did see that she was fragile. And I thought that you saw that she was really shaken by what she'd done. Mm-hmm. But also the whole thing with like the phone call, which we discussed earlier, where we saw that there was like this FBI call. That seemed so obviously like bait.
Yeah.
Like so obviously like bait that actually when somebody showed up, I thought it was going to be the FBI because obviously they would have been tracking who was on that call.
Right.
Yeah. Right? I mean, David, what did you think?
I'm not sure what. All right. So Sam Esmail. I'm confused with, I'm not sure with what look he's always he's trying to go for. The show has a very cold feel to it, right?
Of course.
It's a very cold show. But there's some scenes I just don't know if I can relate to. Like, for instance, this lovely young girl who's playing a Muslim character in New York City, a young Muslim woman. She goes, she lives with her family. She cares about her family. She says she's doing this because of her family. But they have this scene where they're just kind of sitting there all staring at the TV. I don't know if that's a commentary on American life and people just staring at the TV. Maybe that's just commentary on 21st century life. And then she tries and she says, I'm going out. And the parents kind of look over and say, okay, or something like that. It's very dismissive. I'm like, I can't imagine a young woman like that in New York City with everything that's going on right now. If she's saying, I'm just going out in Manhattan, I'll see you later, their parents would be that disinterested in what she's doing. Now, I know that that's the look of the show. Everything's very cold and stale, and these are short responses from people, but sometimes I feel like I lose the humanity of some of these characters. I don't feel like I can relate to them because they seem so different.
Well, it's not called Mr. Humanity.
I know, but it's just, I don't know. It's just, that's the thing for me. I noticed in this episode, I'm like, well, her parents just let her just go. I mean, I know she's a woman, but they just let her just go out and be like, I'm going out. Okay.
Man, David's gonna be a tough dad.
Well, what I was doing, I mean,
you're dead. And the reason, you know what's going on.
Well, the reason why I asked is I grew up in the suburbs in the country, and even when I went out, my parents wouldn't know where I was going, who I was gonna be with. You know, and I was a dude. I was a 6 foot dude. I mean, I could handle myself.
Griffin keeps a, she's got it all locked.
I think I'm going a little bit of a tangent, but like I said, I feel like sometimes I can't relate to these characters. They feel so other than.
Yeah.
And that kind of bothers me. I'm like, am I supposed to be able to relate to you? I feel like I can't get in the heads of some of these characters. Elliot, it's fine. But with some of these other characters, I just don't get it.
Well, he invites you into his head.
Exactly.
I mean, for me, the thing was I just, there wasn't a huge push forward, but the best scene for me, although it bugged me how it started, mm-hmm. was Angela at the bar. Yeah. What bothered me was when she got up and she was singing Everybody Wants to Rule the World. Yeah. I thought that was a cool moment, but it felt like such a TV moment, like a writer sitting there mm-hmm. being like, I know,
yeah.
and mm-hmm. writing that thing because
like
it was
a depressed karaoke.
Yeah, and it was so out of character for her, mm-hmm. but then I thought everything else that happened at the bar was really interesting when she turned on that one neighbor and she was like, that's who I am. That was a great moment.
Yeah.
There were some really interesting moments, but the rest of the characters, like, I just don't really care as much about.
I'm with you. They haven't really developed those that we feel for them.
I'm happy that we got more backstory with them. We got to see your family, see where she lives. Like, I'm glad, but just in that moment, it felt so like, is this a family? Is this a home? Like, it just felt weird. I don't know. I don't know, maybe this was
the weakest episode of the season.
Still great. I still enjoy the show. I'm still can't wait to see what happens next. But I think because we got the big reveal with Elliot the week before, I wanted to see Elliot.
Yeah.
We didn't
and
get
I
Elliot.
To see some White Rose, man. Yeah. Like, well, come on.
And this was the episode of The Walking Dead this year where Glenn gets. The spoiler is up there of this, whatever. Glenn falls into the dumpster, and then we go a Morgan standalone episode, and then two episodes where we know what happens with Glenn.
Right.
I'm like, come on, we just saw Elliot in prison, and you're just going to give us a standalone Darlene episode?
Yeah.
With a woman who's a lawyer that we really don't care about?
Wait,
anyway.
She's a lawyer.
So she's a lawyer, and they go to a trial.
Got it.
She'll be on The Good Wife.
Good Wife season 8. So out of 5, how many are you giving this one? I'm going to go 3.5 out of 5.
I would give it a 3.8.
Okay.
I'll give it a 3.5.
Okay.
Mm. I like it when he does it. He just goes.
It is good. All right, guys. We are going to go into a pilot review. We all watched Gamora on the Sundance Channel. It was released. A lot of our fans, and thank you so much for getting us into this, because a lot of our fans from England and from Europe have been able to watch this show already, and it just debuted. Sundance Channel obviously has the rights to it. Just debuted on Sundance. If you ever watched the movie Gamora, it won Sundance, I think, like in 2007, maybe, the jury prize Sundance.
It was really good.
It was really good. Takes place in Naples, where a lot of my Italian heritage is from.
Based off a tell-all book.
Yeah. About the crime syndicates in Naples. And mm-hmm. if you go to Napoli in Italy, it is a rough place. I got robbed there at a train station. Like, it is not the nicest area, but you have to go through Napoli to get to the Amalfi Coast. Like, that's the train station you have to get to. So it's kind of a port and a hub. And there, I think at one point in like 2011, 2012, their unemployment rate was like 29%.
Wow.
So it was like a serious, serious recession in the city of Napoli. And these huge crime syndicates started taking over the city. And you see in this show, like, the turf wars that are really going on. I loved this show. Even I'll be the first one to tell you, I don't love subtitle show because I get really distracted really easy.
Because
you put down the book. Yeah,
You want to see a book on the screen.
Yeah.
But then I catch myself, like, after watching the show, and Amanda's like, what's going on? I'm like, come on, is it? And I'm like, she's like, stop talking like you don't know Italian. I'm like, well, I know a little bit. But I thought this show was so well done because we saw the first basically 2 episodes. The lead guy, Chiro, who they call the immortal one, he gives bald guys like David.
He looks good bald. He's rocking it.
He's a good looking.
He's got a good looking lady too at home.
And those Italians on their motor scooters, and it makes me want to go back to Italy really badly. But it also really puts a sickening tone on what's going on because it's so raw, and they don't have. There is no remorse for murder in this show. They kill everybody.
And it also, like, I think when I remember one of the quotes, I don't know if it was A.O. Scott from the New York Times, one of the big critics when the movie came out said, "It's the best crime film ever made, the best mafia film ever made, because it strips all the romanticism, all the pretense off of The Godfather. Godfather is one of my favorite films, so it's very pretty and romantic. Everybody's really good looking. This is rough.
Yeah.
This is probably, if you were a gangster in Naples, this is probably what it would look like. And it's so good. Like you said, Chiro is fantastic. I like the guy who plays Don Pietro. Yeah. I like his wife.
Yeah.
I love the boss's lady in that whole couch thing. They had the whole couch thing going the whole time. They had to get a new couch every time.
Decorations in the
decorations,
house.
Decorations. All
so
gold.
So good.
If Donald Trump lived in Naples, That's what his house looked like.
Okay, so I am going to be... I'm going to follow Sasha. I'm going to be a little bit negative.
No.
I loved the first 15, 20 minutes of it. Mm. And then I started getting a little bit... And I felt like such a lazy American. I kind of got sick of reading subtitles. And I didn't really feel any connection with any of the characters. Because they're so awful that I couldn't back anybody. Like, I couldn't actually say, like, I care what happens to any of these characters because they're doing such bad things that I kind of want something bad to happen to all of them. And but it's 2.5 hours. So it's a commitment. Then, so I, like, slogged through the next, like, 45 minutes.
Yeah.
And I was a little bit disappointed. And then I thought, like with most television, the pilot's never as good as the second episode. The second episode was much more interesting. And there was that sickening moment in the nightclub where I was like, But I respected it. I didn't love it.
Okay. See, here's the thing. I think I get what you're saying about how these gangsters are, they're not redeemable people. They're not good people. But when you're, when you are in that position and you are, it's desperation, right? You're put in this position. You have a choice. I understand that. But there is sort of a desperation involved in Chiro and everybody else that you, you fall into that trap, and it's a sexy thing.
I actually like Don Pietro's son. I think he's he's redeemable. He's like on the border, like he's spoiled, doesn't have the best parents, but like he's right.
Doesn't have the best parents. His dad's a multi-million-dollar heroin trafficker.
Jesus.
My dad's a good guy. Killed 46 people last week.
He means well.
Bought me a motorbike.
He
had to earn that bike. He had to earn that bike. Remember, his mom was going to give it to him at first, and he had to earn it. Now they get the bike.
See, because like if you go to Tony Soprano or something, and again, this is me being a lazy American and like needing to be spoon-fed a little bit. There were things about him that were really likable. And I just wanted there to be at least one character on the show who lived, who I was like, I like you and I want to watch you. Like, the main dude, I'm just like, I kind of hope you get shot.
Chiro?
See, I love Chiro.
I like Chiro. He's just like, he's just, he just handles his business. Yeah. I respect a man like that.
All right, Chinesti, what do you think?
Minus the killing.
Well, I know nothing about this culture, but I will say that I felt like it was really authentic and it felt really foreign, which I appreciated. Like it was something really different. And I also really liked that they set the tone from the very beginning. Like they made it something right away. Like I wasn't waiting to like be intrigued. I was actually intrigued from the very beginning. Subtitles are difficult. Like you have to be in the right mindset to want to sit down and watch
an hour and 45 minutes.
It's a lot, and it is like a little exhausting because it is such a dark show, and even like visually dark, you know. So it's like after a while, I'm with you, Sasha. I was kind of like, ugh, like it's a lot to take in. But and, I mean, story wise, it's interesting and it's really well done. I don't know if I can. I don't know.
As a movie, I could have watched it as a movie. I would have preferred to have watched it as a movie because when you have a larger screen and you can read the subtitles in a bigger format, I think that would have been more enjoyable for me. I don't know that I would put this on my DVR.
Because like, I look, next week's 2 hours again. It's another 2 hours.
It's heavy and it's a lot.
Yeah. I don't know. Yeah.
Here's the thing. Maybe I'm a little partial because I romanticize Italian mafia culture.
And I do too, like in The Godfather too. When Michael goes to Italy,
I just said C. I was like, C.
When Michael goes to Italy in The Godfather 1, that's my favorite style. I love when he's in Italy. I love hearing the language because they sing when they talk. It's all mute. Mamma mia.
That was his favorite part. They said Mamma mia twice.
like when the wife is offering the Chiro the couch, she's like, Mamma mia. Like, it's just, I love all that.
It's perfect. Complimenti.
It is good.
Yeah.
I like that.
But, you know, out of, I guess if we're going to do out of five couches.
Do you like how they edit the F words? Just blank space. I'm like, why is there a space there? I was like, why is it so, you know, oh, it's F for you.
Out of five ornate couches, what would you give this pilot?
I would give the look of it, the tone of it, the shooting of it, the style of it, 4.75 ornate couches. Okay. I would give the characters 3 couches.
Can we do about a 3.7?
So I'd give it like a 3.8 overall. Okay. 3.8 overall.
I'm going. I mean, I'm trending hard to like a 4.75 across the board. Like this. I mean, but for me, this doesn't get any better. Real mafia stuff in Italy. I'm like, you know. Italian. I love this stuff. I just want to eat dinner with my parents and like yell about stuff.
I did want pasta after watching the show.
Yeah, of course you did.
Yeah. The thing, like, I'm very proud of who I am and my nationality and my mother, of course. But if I had a choice, if I could be any other race, I would, or like ethnicity or upbringing, I would want to be Italian.
White?
White Italian.
Yeah.
Not Silver Lake Italian?
No.
Not like British dude in London? You don't want to be a British dude in London.
Yes, he does.
I do love the UK, but I'd like to be an Italian who moved to England.
See,
to like be in Snatch or something.
David Griffin, everybody.
We're sorry, Mrs. Griffin. You raised a great man.
And my aunt and uncle are here in the crowd, so, and they're very Italian people, and we have cousins over there. And So we know, you know what I mean? Like, the, it's there's something so it's like beautiful, familial about this show.
They should
so
come like, in. They should come in for this, like, part of it. They should just give you a hug.
It's okay. I love you guys. It's okay. She doesn't want to get on camera. Okay.
She's
let's.
So funny,
oh, so I give it four. Oh, I'm giving it 4.5. Ornate couches.
Shenasty out of 4.5 ornate couches.
I'll give it a 4.2.
4.2.
Yeah.
Here we go. All right, guys, Gamora, check it out on Sundance Channel. That was our pilot review. All right, we're going to go. Yeah, I know. We so have a ton of highs and lows, guys. There's like 15 on
so
here.
So much.
So we're going to try and do these as quick as we can. I'm going to start this out real quick before I let Shenasty take over. Guys, we got some Star Trek Discovery news. Apparently, they're going to start with 13 episodes, and if they get a season 2 or 3, it's going to go to 10 episodes, Fuller is saying. He loves the storytelling like they do on Game of Thrones, the 10-episode format. He thinks that will be... conducive for what he envisions for Star Trek Discovery, and that the female they're calling Number One. That's what they're calling her in this
Number
script.
One.
Make
number
it so,
one.
Number
Make it
one.
So, Number One.
Yes. So I'm going to give 10 episodes a high. I think it's smart. The more episodes, the worse for me.
Yeah, I trust Fuller, too. I mean, coming from Hannibal and all that. Yeah, he's the man.
Cool.
Less time for me to hang out on David's couch because I'm not getting CBS All Access. I'm going to borrow his.
It's like you, Dennis, back there. Like, you guys are all coming over to my house. I'm going to start charging the door, man. $5 a pop, boy.
I'll bring a lasagna for you. Okay. Shenasty, take it over. Let's make some magic happen.
All right. The Fleabag trailer that has David applying for a British passport. He emailed us about this like 2.5 seconds after
all exclamations. He's like, oh my God, you guys, Fleabag trailer.
I love breaking a fourth wall, especially in comedy. And I think this is done really well in the trailer. I'm giving this a high.
Yeah, hi. I'm watching Fleabag.
It looks awesome. Hi. Yeah.
All right, Shenasty, what's next?
The newest Westworld trailer on HBO.
I've said up until now that I didn't like what this show looks like until this trailer. And now I'm like, I'm in.
Oh my God.
This trailer looked so good.
It always looked good. I'm super high for this. I can't wait.
Hi. All right, Shenasty.
New teaser trailers for Flash and Arrow.
Mm.
I didn't see them.
They're 20 seconds. They don't give us anything. Yeah, Barry's I went back in time. Like, we know. We already know. And Arrow's like, I can get hit in the face a bunch. Do you guys want to see
it? Well, one of the Arrow ones was too, like, when I shot, like, the funeral and, like, hey, guess who's dead? It's like, yeah, we know.
We got it.
Yeah, we know.
You're showing us last season. Middle.
I didn't watch.
Just.
Genji Kohan's Glow female wrestling series for Netflix lands Alison Brie.
This.
Dude. Okay, I was so excited for this series.
Yeah.
And now I'm like.
What, you don't like Alison Brie?
I love Alison Brie. She makes no sense in this part.
See, here's the thing. I don't like professional wrestling. I've never really understood it. I understand that it's a huge deal and people love it. But I love 80s culture. And you're giving me an all-female wrestling, like big hair and hot women punching each other.
The gorgeous ladies of wrestling?
The gorgeous ladies of wrestling.
I think the idea is great. They need like the Katie Sackhoffs and like the Gina Carano's for it to make sense. Alison Brie, I could snap her like a twig.
So we're going low?
Okay. I would say miscast, even though I love Alison Brie, especially on Mad Men.
I'm on Alison Brie, so I'm like in the middle down.
Okay. Sinead, what's next?
Lou Pearlman series in development.
Lou Pearlman, if you guys don't know Lou Pearlman, he created like all the boy bands.
O-Town, Backstreet Boys.
With all of them.
NSYNC.
Yeah. Hi, we need more boy band stuff in our life. I'm in. Hi.
Hi. And he's crazy because he did like a Ponzi scheme. Yeah. And like Justin Timberlake called him a Svengali. Love it.
Hi. Shenasty.
All right. Narcos season 2.
Oh, that's season 2 trailer. So high.
Pablo in a robe. Come there.
So good.
Can't wait.
Go before you watch season 2 of Narcos, go watch the 30 for 30 called The Tale of Two Escobars.
Yeah, it's really good.
The soccer player who gets shot after he scores his own goal in the 1994 World Cup here in America, and his crossing paths with Pablo Escobar and what was happening in Medellin, Colombia at the time. Watch that, and then we can talk. And we're going to talk all kinds of stuff about Narcos next week.
I can't wait.
Zing Zang Zong, season 2.
Wait.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
Getting to know the LA Rams on Hard Knocks.
Yeah. This season of Hard Knocks has been incredible. I'm going super high.
These guys do not know where the sun sets and where the sun rises.
Did you guys see the thing I tweeted out where it's like, you guys are all touchy, 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 assy, assy, assy. I'm like, this is the best show ever.
And I don't like to wear tank tops, but that dude is selling me on tanks.
This is fantastic. It's so good.
What's next?
First season of John Krasinski as Jack Ryan will tackle ISIS.
All right, I'm going to go high, but like, duh. What else is he going to tackle?
I know.
I don't think there's another thing.
I just want this to be 13 hours again because he was so hot in that movie.
I trained with Navy SEALs last Wednesday.
do real science, Griffin. No. You know you liked it too.
No big deal. I trained with five Navy SEALs last Wednesday with airsoft guns for the release of Central Intelligence on Blu-ray. It gives me a whole new respect on what soldiers are and how good they are doing things. They killed us quick.
Did like you these, die?
Oh, I got shot like 400 times.
Do you have any bruises?
Oh, all over.
Oh, that's awesome. Yeah,
that was super fun.
Nice.
But, I mean, what else is he going to tackle? ISIS. Hi.
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 Yeah. All right, Sinead, what's next?
The VMAs.
God, it's the worst.
Hold on.
Did you even watch it?
I watched 3 minutes.
Well,
I
then you don't get to judge.
Okay. So here's what was the worst.
Okay.
Britney Spears was so embarrassing.
You guys, but that was the best she's looked in a while. Like, give it to her. She can't get her life together. So if she can get out there
what
and dance
to her? What's
with a
wrong
smile
with her?
On her face.
No, I know, but
she's
why,
old.
Why does she bother she's with, like, old. The microphone when it's literally, like, sing. Sing.
Back streets, back. All right.
That yeah. was what she did.
Well, she didn't sing. She didn't sing any
no,
of
that
it.
Was so I'm like, why are you even putting on the farce with this? But Beyonce.
Beyonce. Amazing.
Yeah, I will say, amazing. I did watch the Beyonce because everybody's like, you don't know anything. Beyonce killed it.
Yeah, she
and
was incredible.
As Sasha just proved, Beyonce is.
You don't even know.
Beyonce proved that she isn't just good for spin class. She's really good at doing other
yeah,
stuff, too.
Yeah, she was
too.
Destroyed. And Key and Peele, after, they were like, dead, toe tag, mortuary, well-attended yeah. funeral. And I was like, yes, yes,
it
all
was so
of
good.
Those things,
it was so
yes.
good.
Okay, Sinead, we're going to give you a little bit of time here because this is.
Oh, God. Was
I'll
it the finale?
This for you because this is tough for
yeah,
you.
Yeah, it's hard.
This Pretty Little Liars is done after season 7.
Right. So we, I mean, okay? we always. Yeah, I mean, I think I'm going to be all right. Okay. We've always kind of known that this is where the show was going to go after 7 seasons. It was going to wrap up. So tonight is the season finale for season 7, part A. And then part B comes back in April, which is the longest we've ever had to wait. Usually comes back in February. So it'll be back in April, and that will be 10 episodes, and then it's done. They've announced that the series finale will be like 2 hours, and the creator of the show, Marlene King, will be directing that. Mm. So right now, leading up to tonight's season finale, we're a little bit closer to finding out like the identity of the secret child, and a lot of the ships are coming back together. And the biggest thing that's supposed to happen tomorrow, I keep saying tonight, tomorrow, mm-hmm. Is a crazy big death, I guess, that Marlene had like called the actor personally to like and tell them that they will be dying, and it's supposed to be like epic, spectacular craziness.
Who do you hope it is?
You know what? I hope that
Lucy
it's
Hale.
Not any of the main
Shay Mitchell.
No. I hope it's not any of the main girls just
that's the only
yet.
Two people I know on the show because that's all on Instagram.
I don't know, you guys. I have no idea. I don't want any of the guys to die because I want them all
Lucy
to
Lucy Hale has a lot of Instagram. She must have as many as a rock.
Yeah. Just the poor little tear for Sinead.
And sad, it's
lives.
Sad. But you
when
know
you say a lot of ships are getting together, is that
come.
Relationships?
Yeah.
Oh my God, that's not the kids. That's not the kids.
All right, let's get it. We got like 5 more to go. Let's go, all Sinead. Right.
Idris Elba's boxing show, Fighter, on Discovery.
Oh my God, all the way up, all the way up, all the way up, all the way up.
I have it on my DVR.
Do you know he had a rate like a racing show about cars? I didn't ever. I
was like a big car guy.
I didn't know there was an old rerun on the other day. I had no idea.
Idris Elba.
Can't wait.
All right, what's next?
Matthew Fisher on Twitter. Hey, Matthew Fisher. He wants us to talk about Wrecked on TBS.
Hey, Matthew.
Yeah, give him a shout out.
Yeah, you're a great dude. Appreciate you following us. We will try and watch Wrecked. We just haven't gotten around to it. It's one of those shows. That's such, we will give it a shot. We will watch it and we will talk about it. Thank you for
always
tweeting
us. We'll review the series finale like The Good Wife.
Yeah,
so
yeah.
Oh my God. We're on an island.
Wait, so we're only going to watch the season finale? Because that I can get behind.
Totally.
Yeah. Matthew will do that for you.
Okay, what's next?
USA con drama with John Cho.
Yeah. Stop it. You put your thumb toward the sky like you mean it. Don't you even, how dare you? What are you talking about? I can't wait for this. And John Cho is the man, and I'm so glad he has his own show.
This is the new USA. This isn't Pacific Blue.
Yeah.
Don't be talking about Pac Blue like that.
Were you on that show?
I love that show.
Are you kidding
me? No, I never watched an episode. I just knew that they would jump the bikes on the Venice boardwalk.
I was going to say, Mario Lopez was
Mario
on that
Lopez
show.
Was
again, correct. Second Mario Lopez today.
That's you say it a third time, he's going to show
oh,
up. So
no, don't say it.
All right, Jay, what's next?
Sarah Paulson and Ryan Murphy's feud.
Sarah Paulson just got cast as the 8th in Ocean's in the Ocho.
Yeah.
Give Sarah Paulson all the roles.
That's
seriously,
what I'm saying.
Yeah, I love it.
So
she's
good.
so good. And I was watching some of American Horror Story Coven.
Yes.
She's even great on that, man. She is Ryan Murphy's muse, and I'm huge up.
Yep, yep,
big
yep.
up.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
NBC wanted The Walking Dead to be a procedural.
They solved it.
So that was their advice. So when Walking Dead was being pitched, NBC's advice to Frank Darabont was to make it more of a procedural, like a Law and Order. They solved it every week. Can you imagine if Walking Dead, they solved it every single week? They solved it.
Versus never solving it ever? It's like the exact opposite of a procedural. Yeah. It's like they still haven't solved it.
They're never going to solve it. The zombies are winning, guys.
I mean, it would be Rick and his son showing up, and he would solve the crime. We solved
it. Maybe if it was a procedural, Carl would get a friggin' haircut. Sinead, what's
next? I
want
to know who that network executive was.
That's hilarious.
He's not working. He's not working at the local Wiener Schnitzel.
Ooh, delicious.
All right, Sinead, what's next?
The season premiere of The Strain, the new season.
I'm the only one watching it.
I watched all of season one, a little bit of season two.
That's where I was.
Skipped ahead 6 months in like time. I have no idea what's going on.
Does Corey Stahl, does he have hair or is he bald?
No, he's bald.
He's a good looking bald man. He needs not to have a wig on.
Shiro should have a little show.
That's right, they should,
All right, last one.
Josh's favorite show, Fear the Walking Dead, of course.
Fear the Walking Dead. I figured out what Fear the Walking Dead is. I figured it out. Okay, here's what happens.
Oh, God.
The director shows up with the cast and he's like, guys, improv an hour of TV and I will make what I think the show would look like.
Cool.
And they're like, awesome.
And he's like,
also, they're going to be zombies. So good luck. And then the cast is like, let's just hang out in a hotel this one. They're like, cool, let's do it. Drinking in a hotel, zombies. Show's over. I was like, ooh, nothing. Keep watching.
But if it was a procedural.
Would they solve it?
They could have solved it. All right, guys, that was Highs and Lows. We're going to go into some Twitter questions. As always, hashtag @ClatterTVTalk. On Twitter, you guys send in some amazing, amazing questions. And again, thank you guys for being fans of the show. Really appreciate it. Tweet us all the time. We just like to hear from you guys. Sinead, what is the first question?
All right, Mike tweets, what are your thoughts on series like Young Justice that get canceled before their time?
We've sort of touched on this before. Shows like Freaks and Geeks is probably like the most classic. Yeah. Another show which we mentioned this episode, Undeclared, I think canceled a little too early. Two Judd Apatow shows that were canceled very, very prematurely.
He's doing okay for himself, though.
Yeah. I think nowadays is that if you cancel on a network, it could survive somewhere else. Like, look what happened in Nashville. Do I watch Nashville? No, but CMT picked it up. And, and you know, you keep people's, the shows that they want to see end. You know, like, when, I think the first show pretty much that this happened with of recent times was Friday Night Lights, which my grandma, my Beanie, loved. And she called me after every episode while that show was going on. She's like, did you see what happened with Riggins this week? I was like, I did. And thank God, because DirecTV picked it up when NBC didn't want it anymore. And I think a lot of pay stations, like a Hulu or a Netflix, I think, do that with the shows, which I think is fantastic.
Well, and isn't that what they're doing with Young Justice? Like, didn't Hulu just pick that up?
Yeah.
And are they going to go to season three? Or was it Netflix?
That's not confirmed. No, they're hoping that Netflix might pick it up. It hasn't been confirmed, though.
Okay.
Because Weissman is on Star Wars Rebels now, I think. So he's been busy with that. For me, it would be HBO's Rome. I know Dennis and I always had this conversation. They actually found out that Rome was actually making money for HBO after they already canceled it. I mean, it made Game of Thrones' budget look weak. I mean, it was up to, like, I think HBO was throwing in $100 million. BBC was throwing another $20 million on top of that. It was just the biggest show on television. And it was so good. And if you look at what they had planned, they're going to go 5 seasons. They're going to talk about, like, the rise of Christ and more of just Augusta and all that kind of stuff. And they had so much stuff going for it, but they had to cancel it because at that time they thought they were losing money on it.
Yeah, and there's so many shows that got cut early that you would like to see, and there's so many shows that were extended to, like,
Deadwood didn't get a full run.
This could have gone.
Luck, sorry, the horse racing. I like
Luck.
Yeah.
Luck was great.
There's shows, though, where, like, it got canceled. I was actually thinking about this because ABC always be canceling. They kill me. They kill Dirty Sexy Money. Love that show. They killed Pushing Daisies. I love that show. There was a show called Traveler. Do you guys remember that? It was like this weird thing where it was sort of like post 9/11. There was a terrorist attack, and, like, these three dudes all go on the run and they don't know who they can trust. But here's what's interesting about it. It was Logan Marshall Green, who would then go on to be in Prometheus and Dark Blue on TBS or whatever, or TNT. And Matt Bomer, who would then, like, blow up on White Collar. So I think sometimes, like, a show can either go off and be on a Netflix, or it can be a testing ground for talent that then can go on to better things.
Oh, great. Sinead, what's next?
All right, Severin Valerie says, what past show of the 80s, 90s, or 2000s you could see being streamed for under 10 episodes?
I thought long and hard about this one because, obviously, I think what he's kind of getting at is what Fuller House is doing. Which I couldn't really get into the new edition of Fuller House. It just felt so hokey to me. But I would love to see if they would bring back those other TGIF shows. Like, what's happening in Step by Step? Give me a little refresher on Step by Step. Because they did it with, what's it called? Boy Meets World. It was Girl Meets World. What do you think?
I think I would like to see Cheers.
Ooh, that's a good one.
I'd like to see Woody Harrelson, those guys at the bar. You know, Ted Danson, those guys doing their thing. I would love to see that.
That would be great.
Or even a new version of Cheers where it's like, what do bars look like now in Boston?
Yeah.
they're still just
the same. I would like to bring back the final cast of Growing Pains, including Leonardo DiCaprio.
Hell yeah. Wow.
And see what's happening with that clan now. Not That's bad. What I want.
There we go. Sinead?
I don't know. Like, after, I was really excited about A Girl Meets World. Yeah. Huge disappointment for me. And I was really excited about Fuller House. Also, another big disappointment for me. I still watch them just because of the nostalgic factor. Yeah. But other than that, like, I, for some reason, I'm getting more and more to the point where I don't want to see it come back. Mm. I just want it to live where it is.
Well, I'm with you.
I mean, we could see a friend. What if we got a Friends 10 episode streaming Friends?
See, I definitely don't want to see that. Oh. No. I don't want anybody to ruin that.
She wants it to be what it was. It was perfect
in
its time.
Just bring back Seinfeld for another 10 seasons, but we won't go into that, Sasha. All right, final Twitter question.
All right, Justice Seymour says, what TV show do you find criminally underrated? Mine is The Leftovers. Do any of you watch it? Anybody? Don't we all watch it?
Except for you.
No, I watched it. I started watching it. I watched the finale of last season, and I was like, this is so good that we went back and started watching it.
I love it.
Interesting
like
way of going about television.
Well, it just happened to be on. I was like, what's this crazy thing happening?
Anytime somebody asks me what the most underrated TV show is, Peaky Blinders. Not enough people watch that show.
I feel like in the day and age of Twitter, it is so difficult for something to be underrated.
Right.
Yeah. Because even stuff that is underrated has like this cult status.
Right. Yeah.
Like, there's really nothing that I think is like, that goes so under the radar, and if it does go under the radar, hipsters find it, and then it's out of the radar, and then they make it like the cool thing that you can't like because they liked it first.
That's what happened with me in flip-flops and jeans.
Jeez.
I mean, I would say if I had to pick a show, probably Deutschland 83 from last year is one of my top three shows. And I know, like,
again, subtitles.
I know it's gonna be hard for you guys to get through it, but it's
reading is so fundamental.
Yeah. It's really good, though.
My teacher mother is so proud that I make fun of reading on the show.
You know what's the most underrated? Bob Ross. Bob Ross, which you can stream on Netflix.
The painter? Happy Little Trees?
Happy Little Trees and A Happy Little Cloud. But did you know you can stream it on Netflix? And it is so relaxing.
Who also has every single episode?
Oh, Bob Ross.
There's a Happy Trees. Like, maybe a rock just lives right here.
Yes.
Maybe a rock lives
here. Isro has ever been flyer than that man's
Isro. Such a positive guy.
Rush.
God, Bob Ross was the man.
All right, that was Twitter questions, guys. Thank you so much. Again, always hashtag at Collider TV Talk. We love hearing from you. This is the time of the show.
Oh, get ready.
Everybody's ready. This week it's Sasha's Pick of the Week.
That was solid.
Sometimes you lose your breath.
I did. You went big.
I'm becoming more excited about that than even talking about the show.
I was going to throw a little wrench in the system and be like, all right, it's time for Sasha's Pick of the Week. But I wouldn't do that to you.
It is time for my pick of the week, and what we are talking about is a show that I have not actually finished watching all of, but I'm getting super addicted to, and that is Kingdom. Kingdom on Audience. What?
One of our fans, when we first said this, you guys need to watch Kingdom.
Yes.
It's fantastic.
It's so good. So you got Frank Grillo, who is running the Navy Street Gym.
Crossbones.
You've got Nick Jonas. Admittedly, he can't act that well. You know what I love, though, is Jonathan Tucker.
Put Liam Hemsworth in it.
Jonathan Tucker kills on this show. But basically what you have is this family, and it's at a gym, it's UFC, and they bring in a lot of real fighters, a lot of real coaches, a lot of real former fighters, like The Tooth, the dude is the photographer, and a lot of real referees. It is so fun to watch. It moves really, really quickly. I feel like it's what Animal Kingdom should have been. But the thing
just
is
add an animal in front of it.
Yeah, but this is way, way better.
Yeah.
I love the fighting style because fighting can be really hard on television, and they obviously speed it up for TV's sake, but it's characters you care about. It's storylines that are like quick and easy. It doesn't feel like a huge emotional investment, yet you want more every time. But the best thing about this show is one of the characters is living in a halfway house, and his roommate, Keith, is, I think, my favorite character on television right now.
Wow.
He calls him his tickle box because they make each other giggle. And Keith, I mean, we all need a tickle box. You know we have giggle time, but sometimes you need... Keith is the best. And every time this character shows up, I'm like, I want a spinoff, just the Keith show. They call it Kingdom of Keith. It's so fun to watch.
It's like Bachelor in Paradise.
So at this point, I am through I'm like almost finished with the first season. I'm about to get into the second. But it's just one of those shows where it's like, oh, it's 10 o'clock at night. I want to watch some TV. Yeah. Night of's over.
Kingdom, guys. I will say, just like to piggyback on you, I love it. I think the one thing that they do so well is that you can almost like smell the gym in the show. You can like see that like raunchy. If you've ever like taken a shower in a bad gym, it's like, oh, that's the worst. Anyway.
The Adventures of Josh Macuga, ladies and gentlemen.
Yeah, there's some old boxing gyms. Anyway, guys, that was it for us here on TV Talk. Now, next week, we have Labor Day, so we won't be here Monday. We will be here Tuesday. Unfortunately, Miss Sasha Perl-Raver will not be here. We got to figure out a replacement. There's no replacing you. This we know, and nothing compares to you, Sinead. Then crush that. You're welcome. We'll be back next Tuesday, and then we've got some awesome TV coming up. We're gonna announce something special next week about the Emmys. There's a whole bunch of fall TV, so you guys, we're coming into a really, really hot spot of television. So stay tuned. Before we go, where can the good people find you, Sinead DeVries?
I'm online at Sinead DeVries and at thatsosinead.com. Here on Mondays hosting Collider TV Talk, on Fridays hosting Collider Movie Talk, and hosting Mailbag over the weekends.
David F. Griffin III.
I'm online at GriffinDE and at GriffinDE on Twitter and Instagram. I just said my name twice for no reason. I could have made that a lot simpler. Also have a little vlog I'm doing on my YouTube page. It's David Griffin on YouTube. I'm not the Cleveland Cavaliers general manager like some of you think, so I don't look like him. So
the crime dog himself.
Please stop complaining about Cleveland's moves.
Sasha Perl-Raver.
You can find me at Sasha Perl-Raver on Twitter and Instagram, and hosting FX Movie Download every Friday and trying to find David a good enough wife.
That's all. That's the only goal we have here on TV Talk. Guys, I'm Josh Macuga. You guys can find me on Twitter and Instagram at Josh Macuga. See me here every Monday, every Thursday with the Schmoes, and on my YouTube channel, The Josh Macuga Show. We release an episode every other Wednesday. Coming up in a few weeks, Sinead DeVries and Ashley Mova. We're on together. All right, guys. Thank you so much for watching Collider TV Talk. We are here every Monday, but again, next week for Labor Day, we'll be here on Tuesday. As always, put down the book, pick up the remote.
Hey guys, if you like this video, click the thumbs up button. Also, make sure you subscribe to our YouTube channel. It'll help you stay up to date with everything we've got going on here at Collider.